On deck at mic one is Susan Berkey.
You're up, Robert.
Thank you for inviting us here tonight to listen to the feedback regarding the assessment standards in New Jersey. As a father of two, I'm a representative of the end results of these standards. Every night, I help my children with their homework. Recently, as Common Core has been in its implementation, I noticed a change in my children's education, for the worse. In many instances, the math is overcomplicated. The lessons try to teach the child what's behind borrowing, and lessons are rushed in an effort to pace them to the test. These practicalities are not only wasteful, they're confusing to the child and discouraging to their learning. One big concern I have, beyond my own children, is how Common Core is affecting the most vulnerable children. We have heard some districts in New Jersey called failing, but the reality is the state of New Jersey is failing them. And they have been failing them. They have been failing them for decades. This is the standard that our government has allowed to become acceptable. The rapid and fundamental changes involved in Common Core leave this segment of our population only further behind. This is an injustice to these young children who have so much potential. And perhaps that is the goal of these standards in the testing system. Those in power are interested in keeping this segment of the population right where they are. The key to move out of poverty is encouraging the love of education, which is the opposite of Common Core and PARCC. We note that the PARCC standards seem to assume that everyone should go to college. And while college is a good aspiration in life, there are other worthy pathways in life beyond that of college that these standards do not account for. We look to our recent college graduates and wonder, will they have a job? Perhaps one of my problems with these standards is that they treat the non-college requiring pathways as if they are menial. When in reality, these are the most stable, productive jobs in our economy. Hard work and discipline should be commended no matter the pathway. Some have said, give PARCC a chance. We parents here, let us use this experimental test on your child during their most productive learning years. Parents have grave concerns related to how Common Core was implemented. Acceptance of standards before they were developed, million-dollar deals with book companies, testing companies, data collection companies, lack of input from New Jersey teachers, lack of input from parents. We noticed that some of the same advocates for PARCC testing and Common Core in our government do not send their own children to schools where it is required. Why don't they stand up for what they believe in? While the focus for the advocates of Common Core and PARCC has been standards, there is no statewide standards for refusing the test. In fact, there have been mixed reactions and communications to parents throughout the state. Some of the communications stated that the parents cannot refuse the test. We, as parents, have rights to direct the education of our children, not the government. To those in our government who would dare to say a voice such as mine is standing in the way of progress, we certainly could ask, the children's progress or yours? We stand right where we belong. We stand right where we belong between the children and those that would steamroll their future. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. On deck at mic two is Gina Crane.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm here as a concerned citizen and parent who also has over 16 years of experience in the classroom and a master's degree in education. There are many angles I could take with this testimony, since I fear there is so much at stake if we get this wrong. But I decided to focus on an organization called Achieve, Inc. As I sorted through this commission's minutes, I could not help but notice many references to this organization. To the unsuspecting eye, this may seem benign, but my many years of research tell me otherwise. Why is this alleged independent commission seeking advice and resources from the very organization pushing the current testing regime? Where are the scholarly experts and independent researchers without a vested interest? Several years ago, when I began to see changes in education that did not feel right, I began my journey into advocacy. I was in a district that had historically high test scores and was labeled a lighthouse district, a beacon for other districts to follow by NJ-CUSAC. I could not reconcile all the changes that were causing us to chip away at our arts and child-centered activities in favor of more and more test prep. We all knew, however, that the best indicator of standardized test results is socioeconomic status or zip code, but we played the game of chasing numbers to meet arbitrary cut scores anyway. One day I woke up and could not figure out what happened to my profession. I began to read and read and read. I literally have read and researched these current education reforms for thousands of hours. I already work a full-time job and have a family, so this time to research was precious energy I chose to exert. You need to understand, I have spent the last several years researching extensively because it is in direct proportion to the amount of concern I have for our children. There is no gain for me in this, except protecting children. Teachers are often accused of having a vested interest. Is a living wage really considered a vested interest? How can we think that a teacher who spends their life caring for children could have more of a financial vested interest than a corporation set to profit in the billions? This journey has taken away precious time from my family, and I would not devote that kind of time if I did not honestly and firmly believe that we are headed in the wrong direction. And honestly, most every teacher I know feels the same. You should start asking them. All this current talk of some silent majority afraid to speak up against us loud and angry activists makes no sense to me, because I talk to the average person every day, and I rarely find any that are in support of these reforms, and those that seem to be are often just uninformed. A quick glance at the recent NJEA polling data on standardized testing will quickly reveal this same truth. Which brings me to Achieve Inc., a Washington, D.C. think tank formed by a group of corporate leaders and some governors who wanted standards-based education across the country. I've had my eye on this group since I began researching. So much of the reading I did, especially in the beginning, kept bringing me back to this organization. The commission describes Achieve as an independent, nonpartisan, nonprofit education reform organization. Sounds lovely. What has not been disclosed is all of the corporate ties and its incestuous relationship with the U.S. Department of Education and all that it stands to gain financially. Should you, an independent group, commission to study in an unbiased manner whether these reforms are good for New Jersey, be tied in any way to the same organization, Achieve Inc., that openly admits that it developed the Common Core and whose goal is to alter states' education policies. I bring this to your attention because it alarms me that an organization's corporate leaders and their corporations are set to profit handsomely by influencing policy that will raise up their bottom line in the name of what's best for children. Many of these corporate self-proclaimed experts have not even stepped into a classroom since they graduated. This is an independent study commission, yet there are corporate fingerprints everywhere. The fox is in the hen house. Isn't it curious that the New Jersey education evaluation system was changed at some point along the way from EE4NJ to AchieveNJ? I resent that Achieve Inc. gets a better seat at the table than I do. They can gain their way into your commission minutes, and I am discouraged to think that my testimony and that of the 63 others here today will fall on deaf ears. Opportunities like these are offered for stakeholders to speak so as to appear that the public has input. It's more of a way for the state to check off a box to say they engaged all the stakeholders. I've testified in Trenton twice this past year and have sat and listened to many, many extremely informed and eloquent speakers present to the State Board of Education with minimal impact. It seems that the agenda is set, and it is in part Achieve's agenda, and there is no swaying the outcome. I've come to call these activities pretend democracy, because we go through the motions realizing the deck is stacked in favor of the reforms. Even many of the independent commission members are heavily entrenched in seeing these reforms succeed. It was mentioned at yesterday's testimony that the only interested commission member seemed to be the one teacher, and even he, I fear, is placed there as a token vested interest whose concerns will be minimized and ignored, much like the opposition that was ignored during the initial Common Core meetings. So So I ask you, as a person whose only interest is the protection of children, to search your hearts and really look at and consider the testimonies you hear today and at all three hearings. I also ask that you look at the most recent NJEA polling data on standardized testing. If you honestly believe that an organization set to profit is more trustworthy than your average citizen fighting for children, then the system is rigged. Game over.
On deck at mic one is Darcy Simarusti.
Hi, my name is Gina Crane. I'm a parent of a 10th grader. The handouts that I gave you, there's a lot of articles in there.
Right,
yeah.
Thank you.
Articles and a lot of homework in there that I've collected from people that I know. Common Core is not a state-led initiative. It was created by a group of leaders and corporations who stand to profit from having a monopoly on education, standardized testing, and our students' personal information. Common Core is heavily funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and Linda Darling Hammond, an education advisor to the current administration. Common Core was introduced in 2010 through the Race to the Top program by the federal government, offering $4.35 billion to states that would adopt the program. To receive the money from the federal government, states were required to change to the Common Core curriculum. In 2011, New Jersey received $38 million to fund teachers' professional development, teacher and principal evaluations, and a transition to new academic standards called the Common Core. Common Core is used for states to receive federal funding for education through Race to the Top and or to get No Child Left Behind waivers. These are tax dollars that we have already paid, and our taxes are being used to force states to comply. Common Core standards takes away the rights of the state and leaves us wide open for the federal government to be completely in charge of our child's education. Education should be run by each individual state, as stated in our 10th Amendment. The power is not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited it to the states, or reserved to the states' respective or to the people. The power to educate the citizens and the children of the citizens rests solely upon the states. With Common Core, the creativity of the teachers to educate our children will be taken away. When a teacher is creative, they engage the student, and the student will gain more knowledge. Taking away the teacher's joy of teaching and having them teach to the Common Core is making the teacher very robotic, which in turn is going to disengage the student. Teachers have the ability to touch a child like no other, but now they're being forced to teach a test because of the park tests that are tied to their evaluations and the schools. Students lose the facts and figures, but demonstrate why things work the way they do. The right answer does not matter so much anymore. It's the process of how the answer is done, which is more of the focus. Cursive writing is no longer taught, and the students will be unable to interpret original historical documents like the Declaration of Independence. Common Core shifts away from classic literature and allows for the reading of informational tests, including song lyrics and government documents, where students will lose the human connection to a book. Checking for spelling is not as important as the creativity when a student writes an essay or a story. Homework assignments saying that the Holocaust may have been used as a propaganda tool and didn't occur. In one of the handouts that I have over there, the eighth graders had to read a story called "Was the Holocaust a Hoax?" where it stated that things like not one body was ever found to have died of gas poisoning. Really? Can you tell that to the people whose family lived through this? You know, watching people counting money now to you at a store is painful. Well, you just wait till Common Core is in full effect, because everyone will have to make a 10 first. Common Core and health, I'm not sure if anyone realizes this, is very sexual oriented. Kindergarten is second. They teach your child the differences of a boy and girl via pictures and discussing parts of the body. Grades 3 to 5 that discuss abstinence and safe sex practices. Now think about the age for a third grader to fifth. Grades 6 to 8 to discuss the signs and symptoms of pregnancy. Are we promoting this at this age? I couldn't read the high school one. I was afraid to. Now there's this genderbread person, which is in the handout there, clipped. It's the clipped part. If anyone wants to see it, it's right here. This genderbread person looks like a gingerbread man to make it appealing to younger children. Young grades will be taught gender identity, to gender expression, to biological sex, to sexual orientation. Our children should not be exposed to this at all. This is for the parents, if they want to discuss this or not with their children, when they deem to be the right age, not for the schools. The Common Core standards are not internationally benchmarked as advertised. In fact, Dr. Sandra Stotsky, endowed chair of teacher quality at the University of Arkansas, refused to sign for English, and Dr. Milgram, from the NASA Advisory Council, refused to sign for math. Both of these education professors were on the creating board and refused to approve and sign their names to these lower standards of English and math because they felt the standards were not appropriate. These standards are developmentally inappropriate for children in elementary grades. They are especially harmful to children with special needs. Pushing all students into the same age peg standards deprives atypical students of optimized learning opportunities and attainable goals at their level of developmental readiness. Our children are individuals and should be treated as such, not hurled into this one-size-fits-all way of teaching. No children learn the same. The FERPA law, which was used to protect children's personal information, is now changed. It is now legal for student information to be shared with corporations and organizations. This data mining of our children's privacy of information is unacceptable and is a violation of their right to privacy. Furthermore, it violates parental rights to protect our children. I didn't sign a piece of paper at the beginning of the year when you get all those papers. I didn't sign anything for that. I don't know if anybody else did. Not every state is complying with Common Core. Many states are opting out of Common Core as well as testing for PARC. Parents, educators, elected officials across the country are questioning the validity, true purpose, and the use course of implementing Common Core. PARC testing. Pearson charges $24 per student to take this test. Pearson's out to make millions of dollars from the testing alone, not including the books that they publish. Pacific Metrics Corporation, IBM are making millions on the technology infrastructure of the test. The bottom line is the students of New Jersey are being used as guinea pigs for Pearson, Pacific Metrics, and IBM to benefit monetarily for unproven and untested high-stake tests that are tied to teachers' evaluations and school performance. Parents are being told they are not allowed to opt out. This is a direct violation of our Constitution. That authority is given to the parent, not the local, state, or federal government via the 14th Amendment, which addresses the rights of the citizens. Another thing, you hear a lot of career and college readiness. In kindergarten, first grade, second, really? What we should be doing is kindergarten to second, which is usually a primary school, should be preparing them for third to fifth, which is an elementary, preparing them for middle, sixth to eighth, preparing them for ninth to tenth, which is the high school, which then prepares the kids for college and careers. I implore you to read and research all the research, this what I have done for the past year. And please, for the sake of our future, get our children out of Common Core immediately. I would like to end with a math problem. This is a second grade, what we used to call word problems, but they're called something else now. Juanita wants to give bags of stickers to her friends. She wants to give the same number of stickers to each friend. She's not sure if she needs four bags or six bags of stickers. How many stickers would she buy so there are no stickers left over? Anybody? Exactly. That is for second graders.
Jacob Hartman, you're on deck in mic two.
Darcy?
Hello.
Hello, you're up.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Darcy Cimaresti. First and foremost, I want to thank you for your time, for your service to the Commission, and to the children of our state. I'm here today as the mom of twin third grade daughters. I serve as a member of the Highland Park Board of Education, but my testimony today is my own and does not represent the board. I currently work for the Network for Public Education, which is a national public education advocacy group founded by education historian, author, and NYU research professor Diane Ravitch. When I read today's NJ Spotlight article about the public testimony in Jersey City, I was startled by your statement, Commissioner Hespe, that you didn't hear anything you hadn't expected. You added that no one offered solutions to, and I quote, the societal problems where half of the students are graduating without the skills and knowledge they need.
So I'd like to offer suggestions and tie them to the conversation that is currently happening at the national level. The Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee is holding hearings to discuss the reauthorization of No Child Left Behind, which is 8 years overdue. Congress has held over 20 hearings on the subject, but has failed to act. With all due respect, Commissioner, to chastise New Jersey's parents and educators for not coming to the table with solutions when our nation's elected officials have been unable to agree on a path forward seems disingenuous at best. Five witnesses testified before the latest hearing of the HELP Committee, a teacher, a principal, a superintendent, a state commissioner, and a research director. Senator Whitehouse, a Democrat from Rhode Island, asked the witnesses how much they thought testing could be reduced while still holding schools and districts accountable for student achievement. The witnesses, with the exception of the researcher, responded that testing could be reduced 50 to 60%. Suggestion one, reduce the amount of testing by no less than 50%. Senator Cassidy, a junior Republican senator from Louisiana, asked the researcher to list the top two factors impacting student achievement. He answered without hesitation, family income and education level of the mother and father. He placed the quality of the education the student receives third. When over 50% of our nation's school children are mired in poverty, it is hard to swallow the idea that new, improved, and wildly expensive standardized tests are the best response to what ails our most vulnerable students. I would submit to you, Commissioner, that it is more likely that the 50% of students you claim are graduating without the skills and knowledge they need are closely correlated to the 50% living in poverty. If we truly want to help those students, what they need is not an expensive, computer-based, standardized test. Suggestion two, New Jersey should abandon PARC. A tremendous amount of the current pushback is caused by the costs districts have incurred to comply with the technological requirements of the PARC. The recent revelation that the state will pay for-profit behemoth Pearson $108 million over the next 4 years for the test alone has confirmed suspicions that the state is paying far too much for an unproven product. The PARC consortium is dwindling. State after state has abandoned PARC and returned to their state tests. New Jersey residents wonder what keeps us tethered to what appears to be a sinking ship, steered by the wildly unpopular Pearson. The money saved by abandoning the PARC can be spent on services for our most vulnerable students. Let's hire social workers and reading specialists. Let's reduce class sizes and provide all students with deep, meaningful learning experiences, not more tests and test prep. As NPE President Diane Ravitch said, just say no to annual testing. No other high-performing nation does it, and neither should we. As long as we continue to disaggregate data based on subgroups, a return to pre-NCLB grade span testing, which requires students to be tested once in each in elementary, middle, and high school, can provide state and federal governments all the data they need. Suggestion three, the state should advocate at the federal level for a return to grade span testing. I do appreciate the state's conundrum. Under NCLB, annual testing is mandated. Therefore, every state is accountable to the federal government, every district is accountable to the state, every school is accountable to the district, and teachers are accountable to everyone. But when it comes to educating their children, it's hard to make an argument that parents are accountable to anyone but themselves. And the vast majority of parents are fed up with the testing that has taken over our schools. This fact was made abundantly clear in the poll released by the NJEA earlier this week. You can try to repackage the tests, rebrand them, and tell us they're good for us and for our kids, but to be frank, on the whole, parents aren't buying it anymore. It's time to actually listen to us. No one else in this broken system seems to be willing to step back and recognize that the weight of what you call accountability rests squarely on the shoulders of our children and their teachers. But as parents, we feel it in our bones. We see our children's teachers and administrators struggling to keep up with ever-increasing mandates. We wince as treasured programs are cut from our schools because funds have been siphoned away to pay for the computers and bandwidth needed for the tests. We see our children lose their love of learning. Is it any wonder that parents and teachers, Democrats and Republicans, are finally standing up, fighting back, and demanding change? We're tired of seeing our children get less for more. Less joy, less learning, less creativity, more stress, more testing, more standardization. The time has come to reclaim teaching and learning. We are asking for your help to do so, but it seems our pleas are falling on deaf ears. If you fail to help us provide our children with the educational opportunities they deserve, and instead continue to answer only to state and federal demands for accountability, you leave us no choice but to refuse the tests, yeah. Which is exactly what I intend to do for my daughters. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Darcy.